A very good morning. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with Breakfast News. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines of this morning. Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister meets Home Minister in Delhi, says violence in state has come down significantly. Centre's newly appointed representative on Kashmir also meets Chief Minister. China says India should shed reservations over Belt and Road initiatives, asks it to join the project, refuses to change stand on Kashmir issue. Rajasthan Assembly passes bill to raise reservation for other backward classes from 21% to 26%, bill opposed by Congress. Karnataka Cabinet clears state policy for transgenders, aim to bring community into mainstream, include them in efforts to promote literacy. And UN panel says Syrian forces behind lethal chemical attack on rebel-held village in April that killed over 87 people, reaffirms Bashar al-Assad's rule must end. The government has extended the deadline by a month till 30th of next month for businesses to claim credit for transitional stock in the goods and services tax regime. Tran 1 is to be filed by those businesses that are to claim credit for taxes paid before the launch of GST on 1st July. The GST Council, in its 21st meeting in Hyderabad, had decided to extend the deadline for filing Tran 1 form to 31st of this month, from September end earlier. It also allowed businesses to revise the form once in the case of any discrepancy. As much as 65,000 crore rupees out of the nearly 95,000 crore tax collection in July, the first month of GST has been claimed as transitional credit by taxpayers. Following this, the Central Board of Excise and Customs had ordered a scrutiny of all such claims above 1 crore rupees. Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday inaugurated a two-day international conference on consumer protection in the South, Southeast and East Asian nations. While inaugurating the meeting in Delhi, he stressed that consumer protection was in line with the government's resolve of building a new India. About 20 countries are participating in the event, including China, Singapore and South Korea, and neighbours Bangladesh and Sri Lanka.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday said that consumer protection is an inseparable part of governance. He also said that a new law to protect consumers is on the anvil, with stricter provisions against misleading advertisements. While inaugurating a global conference on consumer protection in New Delhi, Modi also claimed that consumer protection has been mentioned in the Vedas.
Upabhokta ke hito ka dhyan इस सरकार की प्राथमिकताओं में से एक प्रमुख अंग है। सरकार की ये प्राथमिकता न्यू इंडिया के संकल्प के साथ भी पूरी तरह जुड़ी हुई है। न्यू इंडिया जहां कंज्यूमर प्रोटेक्शन से आगे बढ़कर बेस कंज्यूमर प्रैक्टिसेस और कंज्यूमर प्रॉस्पेरिटी की भी बात को हम बल दे रहे हैं। साथियों, हम आज की देश की जरूरतों को, आज के व्यापारिक तौर तरीकों को अगर ध्यान में रखते हुए एक नया कंज्यूमर प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट ऑलरेडी प्रोसेस में हम बना रहे हैं। नए कानून में कंज्यूमर एम्पावरमेंट पर विशेष जोर दिया जा रहा है।
The Prime Minister further said that consumer protection is among the government's key priorities, adding that it had recently enacted the Goods and Services Tax, which is bringing in a new business culture across the country. He also highlighted the programs launched by the government in the last 3 years to empower consumers.
GST se desh ko ek naya business culture mil raha hai aur long term mein GST ka sabse bada fayda कंज्यूमर्स को ही होने वाला है। मध्यम वर्ग, निम्न वर्ग, गरीब जिसका अज्ञान का लाभ उठाया जाता था, जैसे जैसे लोगों को इसकी जानकारी मिलती जाएगी, ग्राहक जागरूक होता जाएगा और कहीं पर भी अब कोई उसका चीटिंग नहीं कर पाएगा। एक पारदर्शी व्यवस्था है जिसमें कोई कंज्यूमर्स के हितों के साथ खिलवाड़ नहीं कर पाएगा।
The first time that an international conference on consumer protection is being organized by India. The two-day meet will discuss steps taken by the Asian countries to implement United Nations guidelines on consumer protection. Panchanan Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi is on a two-day visit to Mussoorie. On the first day of his visit on Thursday, Prime Minister held an interaction with IAS officer trainees at Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration. He asked them to research governance issues in depth for better understanding. He held the interaction with over 360 officer trainees of the 92nd Foundation course a day ahead of his address to them. During the four-hour interaction in four groups, a variety of subjects such as administration, governance, technology and policy making came up. The Prime Minister urged the officer trainees to express their ideas and thoughts to him frankly and without fear. Prime Minister Modi also stressed on need for them to develop a national vision. The Prime Minister also interacted with faculty members of the academy. Today, Prime Minister will also take part in a yoga session with the probationers and Kendriya Vidyalaya students at the academy. On to news on assembly elections. 349 candidates have been left in the fray for the assembly elections to Himachal Pradesh. This after the last day of withdrawal of candidature ended on Thursday. Elections to the 68-member assembly will take place on November 9th. The ruling Congress and the opposition BJP have fielded candidates for all the 68 seats, while the CPIM is contesting 16 seats. Four cornered contests are on the cards in 22 constituencies, while five cornered contests will be witnessed in 14 constituencies. There are 9 seats for which there will be 6 cornered contests, and for 6 constituencies, 7 candidates each are in the fray. Counting of votes will take place on 18th of December. The Rajasthan Assembly has passed a bill to raise the reservation for other backward classes from 21% to 26%. The bill was passed with a voice vote. The Rajasthan Backward Classes Bill 2017 proposes 5% increase in OBC quota. It was tabled during the monsoon session in the wake of widespread agitation by the Gujjar community demanding reservation under the OBC category. The bill raises reservation for Gujjars and four other backward communities in Rajasthan from 21% to 26% that was earlier grouped as special backward class. Introducing the bill, the Rajasthan Social Justice and Empowerment Minister said that the population of backward classes in Rajasthan is estimated by the State Backward Classes Commission to be about 52%. This, he said, warrants the increase in reservation. The bill was opposed by the opposition Congress, which accused the government of deceiving Gujjars. The Karnataka State Cabinet has cleared the state policy for transgenders 2017. This is aimed at bringing the community into the mainstream of the society and provide its members with a secured life. According to the state law and parliamentary affairs minister, the policy had been drafted in compliance with the Supreme Court order. Different categories of transgenders have been mentioned in the policy. The aim is to create awareness about the transgender community in all the educational institutions of the state. Also, reaching out to family members through Anganwadi workers to sensitize them about trans children. Bring into place a monitoring committee or cell at the educational institutions to address the issues of discrimination, sexual abuse and violence against transgenders is included in the policy. The policy also moves defining the indicators for a friendly policy and to include the community in Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, right to education and similar efforts to promote literacy. On to West Bengal, where the death toll due to dengue has risen to 36 this year. Over 20,000 people have been tested positive for the vector-borne disease. According to the West Bengal Director of Health Services, the number of dengue deaths might go up in the coming days. Most of the dengue cases have been reported from the districts like Howrah, Hooghly, North 24 Pargana District, South Damdam and South 24 Pargana. Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister Mehbooba Mufti met Home Minister Rajnath Singh in Delhi on Thursday. After the meeting, the Chief Minister said that the violence in the state has come down significantly. The hour-long meeting was attended by senior officials of the Home Ministry and the Jammu and Kashmir government. The meeting was called by the Home Minister to discuss over 80,000 crore rupees development package announced by the Prime Minister. The Home Ministry later said that the government has decided to fast-track projects under Prime Minister's development program. Meanwhile, the centre's newly appointed special representative for Jammu and Kashmir, Dineshwar Sharma, also met the Chief Minister. He discussed the broad contours of the proposed talks with all the stakeholders. The meeting comes 2 days after the centre announced his appointment. Sharma is likely to begin his maiden visit to the valley next week in his new role.
मुझे पता है कि कश्मीर घाटी में भी उसका स्वागत किया जा रहा है और इससे कश्मीर की वर्तमान स्थिति में सुधार लाने में सरकार को काफी सहायता मिलेगी। नहीं जो बात करने के लिए आगे आएंगे उनसे बात होगी, जो बात नहीं करना चाहेंगे उनको कौन जबरदस्ती करेगा?
NIA searches were carried out at the residence of Hizbul Mujahideen chief Syed Salahuddin's son in Badgam in central Kashmir on Thursday. The investigation agency seized phones, laptops and other documents. Shahid Yusuf was arrested by NIA 3 days back for allegedly receiving funds from overseas for subversive activities in the Kashmir Valley. He is presently in the custody of the agency for 7 days. According to NIA, 42-year-old Shahid, who works in the agricultural department of Jammu and Kashmir government, has given the names of overseas Hizbul Mujahideen members involved in fundraising for the terror outfit.
भारत सरकार ने जैसे एक अधिकारी को मनोनीत किया है देशमर शर्मा जी के रूप में बातचीत की और चर्चा को आगे निरंतर बढ़ाने के लिए उसके साथ एनआईए या आतंकवादी विरोधी ऑपरेशंस का कोई संबंध नहीं है कई वर्षों के बाद कई दशकों के बाद एक निर्णायक कार्रवाई देखने को मिल रही है कश्मीर घाटी में आतंकवादियों के प्रति आतंकवादियों के समर्थकों के प्रति
NIA has also filed a charge sheet against Zakir Naik in a hate speech and incitement case. The controversial preacher has been accused of spreading hatred by his provocative speeches, funding terrorists and laundering several crores of rupees over the years. The 51-year-old televangelist who is currently abroad is being probed under terror and money laundering charges by NIA. He fled from India in July 2016 after terrorists in Bangladesh claimed that they were inspired by his speeches. The NIA had on November 18, 2016 registered a case against Nayak at his Mumbai branch under various sections of the Indian Penal Code and Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. His Mumbai-based NGO, Islamic Research Foundation, has already been declared an unlawful association by the Union Home Ministry. And on to the Chhat festivities. The Chhat Puja celebration that began on Thursday evening ends today with devotees paying obeisance to the setting sun and rising sun for sustaining life on earth. The Chhat Puja is mainly celebrated in northern parts of India, where thousands of devotees throng river banks carrying wicker baskets filled with fruits and offerings to the sun god. We slip into a very short break with glimpses of this festival.
The sacred relics of Buddha were unearthed in Pipravava in Uttar Pradesh. Buddhist monks from all over the world visit the National Museum to pay their respects.
These charred bone fragments of Buddha are housed in the gold canopy gifted by the royal family of Thailand.
Welcome back. President Ramnath Kovind will be on a two-day visit to Kerala. This is his second visit to the state in a month. On the first day, the president will launch the Techno City project and lay the foundation stone for the first government building in Techno City. Chief Minister Pinarayi Vijayan and other state ministers and officials will attend the function. Later in the day, he will pay tributes to social reformer Ayyankali by garlanding his statue and also attend a civic reception hosted in his honour. On October 28th, the president will travel to Kochi to grace the valedictory function of the Diamond Jubilee celebrations of the High Court of Kerala. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu has said that country must skill its young population not only for the economic benefit but for social reasons too. He was addressing the inaugural of the Skill Development Centre at Swarna Bharat Trust in Hyderabad.
Addressing a gathering of young trainees in Hyderabad, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu called on the youth to acquire skills to become proficient in skills that generate employment. That skilled youth is an asset for a country like India.
మొదటి నుంచి ఆఖరి వరకు కోర్సు మనకు ఉచితంగా ఇస్తున్నారు. ఎక్కడైనా కోర్సులు పెడతారు, రేగ్గాది ఇవన్నీ, కానీ డబ్బు ఆర్థిక శక్తి అందరికీ లేదు. కానీ ఇక్కడ స్వర్ణ భారత ప్రత్యేకత ఏంటంటే 45 రోజులు 90 రోజులు నీకు శిక్షణ, నీకు వసతి, నీకు భోజనం, నీకు మార్గదర్శనం అన్నీ ఉచితంగా ఇచ్చి నువ్వు వెళ్ళేటప్పుడు నువ్వు ఏదైనా సొంతంగా చేసుకుంటానంటే ఆంధ్ర బ్యాంక్ నీకు లోన్ ఇస్తారని చెప్పడం అయితే ఉందో ఇలాంటి అవకాశం చాలా అరుదైంది. అందుకని
Naidu, along with Telangana Deputy Chief Minister Mehmood Ali, inaugurated a skill development course in CCTV and optic fibre with L&T and heavy vehicle driving on simulated training with Gati in Swarn Bharat Trust in Hyderabad. While delivering the inaugural speech, the Vice President called on the private sector to create opportunities for training and skill development.
ఆర్థిక అసమానతలతో సతమతమయ్యేవాళ్ళు, సాంఘిక వివక్షతో బాధపడేవాళ్ళు, వైద్యం అందకుండా పోయేవాళ్ళు, విద్యకు దూరంగా ఉన్నవాళ్ళు ఉంటే అది అభివృద్ధి చెందినా శక్తివంతమైన దేశం అనిపించుకోదు. అందుకని దానిపైన అందరూ కూడా దృష్టి పెట్టాల్సి ఉంది. కేంద్ర ప్రభుత్వం దృష్టి పెడుతుంది, రాష్ట్ర ప్రభుత్వం దృష్టి పెడుతుంది. అయితే అన్ని పనులు ప్రభుత్వమే చేయాలనుకోకుండా మనం కూడా మన వంతు కర్తవ్యాన్ని చేయాలి. అందుకని ప్రభుత్వ ప్రైవేటు భాగస్వామ్యం ఉండాలి, పబ్లిక్ ప్రైవేట్ పార్ట్నర్షిప్.
Naidu also expressed concern over very low penetration of health insurance at individual levels in the country and said that health expenditure borne by households is out of the reach for poor families. He also asked the private sector to extend their support in extending basic health care and insurance for employees. Raj Kamal's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi has alleged that the government has hit the country's economy by firing double-tap shots of note ban and GST on it. Addressing the 112th annual session of the PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry in Delhi, he alleged that the goods and services tax was flawed. He said that Congress's position is that the GST has to be reformed and changed. The Congress leader described demonetization as a decision taken without thought or consultation. He accused the centre of crippling small businesses.
Today, the national discussion is only about growth. India can no longer carry on without a clear focus and strategy on the creation of jobs. How are we going to create jobs? That is the central question in front of this country today.
China has said that India should shed its reservations on One Belt and Road Initiative and join the project as it will not change Beijing's stand on the Kashmir issue. Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson said that China welcomes other countries, including India, to participate in the OBOR initiative on the basis of voluntarism. He added that the initiative will not affect China's position on relevant issues and its position on relevant initiatives will not be changed. The goal of the OBOR is to promote connectivity between regional countries and common prosperity of all countries. China also said that the initiative will bring tangible benefits to those countries who are participating in the project at an early date. The BRI, which includes China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, has been included in the constitution of the ruling Communist Party of China in the just concluded once in a five-year congress. On to international news now. The US government has released several thousand files on the assassination of former President John F. Kennedy, but withheld others on national security grounds. In a statement on Thursday, the US National Archives said it had released 2,891 records related to the November 22, 1963 killing of Kennedy in Dallas in Texas, citing potential irreversible harm to the nation's security. U.S. President Donald Trump said that he had no choice but to restrain some 300 files. He has placed those files under a six-month review while letting 2,800 others come out, raising a deadline to honor a law mandating their release. The 1992 law mandating release of the JKF document states that all the files shall be publicly disclosed in full within 25 years, unless the president certifies that continued postponement is made necessary by an indefinable harm to the military defense, intelligence operations, law enforcement, or conduct of foreign relations. The law, however, doesn't allow the president to hold some records back. Catalonia braces for Spain takeover. This after backers and opponents of independence in Catalonia clashed in Parliament over the way forward. In a heated meeting in Catalan Parliament on Thursday evening, the MPs struggled to find a consensus over their next move. Catalan President Carles Puigdemont did not reveal a favoured course of action and called on MPs to decide on a response. This as he backed away from a plan to call new elections to break the deadlock between the central government and separatists. Puigdemont had been expected to announce an election in order to counter Madrid's move to take direct control of autonomous Catalonia.
Saben que he estat disposat a convocar aquestes eleccions sempre i quan es donessin unes garanties que permetessin la seva celebració en absoluta normalitat. No hi ha cap d'aquestes garanties.
Today, Madrid has scheduled a vote in the Spanish Senate in which members will decide whether to suspend Catalonia's autonomy under Article 155 and put it under Madrid's control. If the article is invoked, Spain would take control of Catalonia's finances, police and public media, and new regional elections would be held. The developments come after Catalonia's independence referendum on 1st of October. Madrid slammed the referendum as illegal, but Catalan leader took its result as a mandate to declare a split from the country.
Pedimos su autorización para trabajar por la normalidad, para trabajar por la tolerancia, para trabajar por la buena convivencia. Para trabajar por la concordia, para trabajar por la democracia.
US investigators have said that Bashar al-Assad regime in Syria is responsible for the deadly sarin gas attack on the rebel-held town in the northwest that killed more than 87 in April this year. The report will increase pressure on Assad's regime. The US also renewed calls for him to step down. The report is the first time that a politically independent investigation had concluded which side in Syrian civil war had carried out the attack on the village Khan Sheikhoun. The early morning attack killed dozens of civilians, including children, and is regarded as one of the worst chemical weapon atrocities in the conflict. The investigative panel was created in 2015 by the United Nations Security Council to determine who has been using chemical weapons in Syria. The US has announced new sanctions on North Korea. The US Treasury Department issued new sanctions on seven individuals and three entities connected to the North Korean regime. The sanctions are in response to the State Department's report on human rights abuses by Kim Jong-un's regime. The sanctions freeze any property or interest in property within US jurisdiction and generally prohibit transactions by US citizens with any of the sanctioned individuals or groups. Among the sanctioned entities are the government of North Korea and the Workers' Party of Korea. Other sanctioned parties include North Korean diplomats, military security officers and officials with the state-owned construction companies. The actions come as the U.S. presses the regime to end its nuclear weapons testing and missile launchings. On to sports news now. FIFA on Thursday lauded India for delivering a hugely successful Under-17 World Cup. Addressing a press conference in Kolkata along with All India Football Federation President Praful Patel, FIFA head of the competitions Remy Yarza said that the infrastructure provided for the first ever FIFA tournament in India was world class. He also added that all the teams were happy with the organization. Yarza further added that FIFA Under-17 tournament has catapulted India to a global stage and it has shown that it's a footballing country. While AIFF President Praful Patel said that India has made a bid for 2019 FIFA Under-20 World Cup and he will present the country's case when he addresses the FIFA Council to be held today in Kolkata. India lost to Australia in the high-scoring encounter in their fourth match of the seventh Sultan of the Johor Cup at Taman Daya Hockey Stadium in Johor Bahru in Malaysia. Ace tennis player Dilpreet Singh and Sanjay scored a goal for India while Joel Rintala, Kobe Green, Jonathan Bretherton and Nathan Ephraimans scored for Australia. Australia defeated India 4-3. India will now face Britain in their fifth match on Saturday.
Swept home by Scanlon. Or was there a touch from Ephraimans in front of the goalkeeper? Just confirmed by...
Saina Nehwal has crashed out of the ongoing French Open Super Series tournament in Paris while PV Sindhu has advanced into the quarterfinals. Former world number one, Saina lost in the straight games to Japanese fifth seed Akane Yamaguchi 9-21, 21-23. This is her second loss within a fortnight. Saina lost to Yamaguchi in the quarterfinals at Odense. Olympic silver medalist PV Sindhu stormed into the quarterfinals. Sindhu defeated Japan's Sayaka Takahashi 21-14, 21-13. She will now face China's Chen Yufei. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.